Hello students, and welcome back to my channel Let's Learn Together. In today's video I'm going to discuss with you the poem The Ball Poem, which is the part of class 10th NCERT textbook First Flight. Right, I will be using this particular book as a source of reference, and I'll try to give you my interpretation of the poem. As I always say that you are free to have your own subjective interpretation of the poem. So I'll just look at the poem and try to discuss it to you from my point of view. You are free to have your own point of view, right? So this particular poem, after having read it, I would just recommend you to sit with the book if you are watching this video, or at least when you watch this video, you should have by now read the textbook. This particular poem, which is a very short poem, and read it as many number of times as possible, like twice or thrice or four times or five times maybe, because when you read the poem in its entirety, you'll start getting the sense that is, you know, that needs to be reached out to the reader. So it is very clearly, you know, the poem is about ball, as the title itself suggests. It's a ball poem. But if you are an intermediate learner by now, you know that literature is never about, it's never just about surface meaning. Literature is about multiple layers of meaning. It's about understanding how one particular thing could signify a different idea altogether, or a particular event or a character could, you know, remove the layers and layers of meaning and make the whole idea into a very complex one. So you need to understand that the particular poem also is not just about the ball, but it is about ball. It is about a child who is playing with the ball, but it is much more than that, right? So in that way, you find the poem a very suggestive poem, because it suggests variety of ideas and variety of complex ideas about human life, about human emotions, and about human perspective, right? So this particular poem, as I said, that you need to read it, and I am very quickly now moving on towards the interpretation of the poem. So let us look at the first few lines over here, and I'm just going to read down the first four lines. Please follow in your textbooks. What is the boy now? Who has lost his ball? What is he to do? I saw it go merrily bouncing down the street and then merrily over. There it is in the water. Right? These are just the first four lines of the poem. And if you look at these lines, you know, there's one thing that strikes me, and it should strike you also, that the poem itself begins with a sense of loss. That is very important. It's going to be very important, because this whole idea of sense of loss is going to run throughout the poem. It is going to be in, you know, it's going to be the major undercurrent throughout the poem. So look at the first line itself. What is the boy now? Who has lost his ball? You know, the reason why I'm thinking it in this way is that, you know, the poet or the narrator would have just begin presenting before you an image where a little child is playing with the ball and is very happy while playing with his ball. But then he decides very, you know, consciously, the writer is deciding, or the poet is deciding, to give you a certain sense by making in the first step itself, boy making his ball loose, which means that there is a very strong sense of loss which is there, right? What is he to do? I saw it merrily bouncing down the street and then merrily over where it is in the water, right? Then he says that, what will the child do now? Because now he was like playing with the ball and the ball has gone. So there is this narrator who is giving you a first person narrative, and he's looking at this boy and he's telling you about what has happened. And now he does not know that what the child is going to do, because he has lost his one of the most important and very precious possession. Right? For a child, a ball would be very important, isn't it? We all have actually been through this experiences of playing with toys and balls and many other toys. At that time when we were child, those toys were very important for us. Of course, as we grew up, priorities changed, but then at that particular period of time, the ball was extremely important, because that was the most cherished possessions that we had, right? So now that is why the narrator is saying that what is going to happen? Now what will the child do, right? Because the ball has gone merrily bouncing as in, you know, it was very happily going through. The ball was very happy going out of the house, out of the clutches of the boy, and it just entered the very near water body. There is some water body over there. We do not know what it is. It could be a drain, it could be a pond, maybe it could be a river, whatever it was. But then it moves into the waters, okay? Now, the reason why the ball has not gone somewhere nearby but has gone into the into the waters could be suggestive that now it is very difficult for the child to get into the water and get the ball back. So the loss is probably, you know, it's going to be permanent because he's not going to get that particular ball back. He might get different balls, but this ball which was being played by this little child will never be got back by him because it has gone into the water. So understand that it's not just about the sense of loss that has happened, but it is also about a sense of permanence in the loss. Because once you lose something, no, you can replace it by any other thing, but that particular thing never comes back to you. So there could be replacements of a particular possession, but the same thing, the same person, the same relationship, the same memory will never get back to you. Now I hope you understand that ball is not just a ball over there. It is the most prized possessions that human beings have, you know, at a particular time. It could be, as I told you, your loved ones. It could be about your possessions, your luxuries, your things, your achievements. It could be about your most prized memories of the people. It could be about your relationships. It could be about your family member, friends, relatives, whoever. Relationships means people who are around you. So once you lose these things, you know, once you lose a person or a relationship or any other thing, you can replace it by another one. But are you going to get that particular thing back? No. Right? And then he says that when he looks at this, the boy gets transfixed with grief, because he also knows that the loss is irreversible. It is not going to come back. The same thing is never going to come back to him. I'll just read another few lines from the poem and then try to give you the interpretation of them. No use to say, oh, there are other balls. An ultimate shaking grief fixes the boys as he stands rigid, trembling, staring down all his young days into the harbor where his ball went. Okay, so this is just about now the psychological consequence of losing the ball within the boy. Now he feels really bad. He is in grief and he's in immense pain, maybe, because he knows that he might get different balls, but that particular ball will never be back with him. So he says that, no, the speaker in the poem says that there is no point even if I console the boy by saying that, look, there are other balls also, you can get any other ball. Something that we generally tell our children. Because if there are young kids around you, you will find that once, you know, they lose their toys or their toys get damaged or broken by any reason, it is difficult for them to, you know, console them. And you can replace it, but still the memory of that particular toy will always remain with them. So he says that there is no point in consoling him by saying that there are other balls, because he is not going to get consoled, because the joy is about leaving that or about losing that particular ball which will not come back. And he's transfixed with grief and pain and disappointment in his eyes, and he's feeling very bad about it. So this is, you know, here there is an opportunity as a reader for you to understand what ones actually feel like when there is a loss that happens to you. Now of course we all have been through it, but then it's like you need to start feeling the idea of pain, or you need to understand the idea of pain, not just from your perspective, but from the perspective of a little boy and from the perspective of any other person. Because then that makes you a more sensitive person and a more tolerant person. Because you know that it's not just your grief which is biggest in the whole world, but there are griefs. Each and every person is going through grief. Each and every person is going through sadness of losing something or other, losing someone or other, isn't it? So he says that this boy is trembling, straying down. So he's just looking at that water body wherever the ball has gone, and he's just trying to understand. He's just trying to remember those days when he used to play with his balls. Next few lines I'm reading from the text. I would not intrude on him. A dime, another ball is worthless. Now he senses first responsibility in a world of possessions. Right? I'm stopping here. There's three lines over here. He says, I would not intrude on him. Now he's saying, the speaker says that now I'm not going to try to console him. Intrusion means entering somewhere without permission. So when you are entering a particular territory without any permission or without any right to enter there, then it is called intrusion. So he says that I'm not going to kind of console him. I'm not going to talk to him about that loss, and because he needs to learn his lessons on his own. Now this is interesting. When you look at the poem, when you read the poem, you find the lines are very direct and the language is extremely simple, and it's very easy for us to find out the meaning, as you say, of the words and the sentences. But when you think about it little deeper, you know that he's talking about life, and he's talking about really, really deeper concerns of life with which all of us are infected with, right? He says that the child has been through a loss. He must learn his lessons on his own. I should not just go and, try to talk to him about getting him a different ball and diverting his eye. That's what we generally do with the kids. That whenever they lose things, we just try to make them happy by get them another set of things and ensure that they don't actually feel bad. But what we're doing is that we are curbing the kid's ability to learn from the losses and to learn from the incidents that have happened with him. Now, this is a severe damage to anyone's personality, because loss is inevitable. It will definitely come to you or to any other human being, but suffering is definitely optional. So once you understand the nature of loss, you realize that loss is something that will happen. That is very much the part and parcel of human life. But to suffer and to feel pain about it is something which is in an individual's control. You might go through a loss, but still may come out of it without suffering the loss. And that will come with an understanding and realization that loss is inevitable and pain is optional. Suffering is optional. He says that I'm not going to teach the child anything, because he must now derive his lessons on his own and he must teach himself accordingly. Okay, so he says that he senses his first responsibility in a world of possessions. So it is a world of possessions. Possess is to have something, is to keep something with you and to feel yourself the rightful owner of it, right? You might have a piece of land in your name. Now, maybe you have earned it, maybe you have got it as a part of property from your family, from your father. Now, you are the rightful owner of it, you possess it. Right, you are the rightful owner of it. So when I say that it is mine, I'm actually saying I am its master and it will act according to me. Now he says that now there is this world of possessions that we live in. So we don't just possess outward things and luxury and things like that, but we possess relationships also. Now that is really, really dangerous, because when we are in a relationship with our parents, siblings, friends, loved ones, anyone, we somehow feel or we always mistake that these relationships are our possessions, and we are the masters of those relationships, instead of feeling gratitude about having those wonderful relationships with us, and instead of actually investing and keeping them lovingly with us, we try to own them. Now that is something that gives rise to suffering, because loss is natural but suffering is man-made. Okay, so he's saying that now he must learn his first responsibility or his first lesson of living into the world of possessions, because here we find each one and every one of us owning something or other. Like we own things, we own properties, we own various other luxurious things, so much so that we have feeling that we own people also. Right, and then this feeling of ownership is something that leads to suffering. This feeling of ownership is something that, pushes you into the state of pain. And he says that he will have to learn his lessons on his own. I'm reading the next few lines from the poem. People will take balls. Balls will be lost always. little boy, right? People will take balls. Now you know that balls is not just a ball here. Balls is possessions, and possessions may refer to the variety of things, as I just told you. It would refer to many things. I just told you about luxuries, about items, about property, about people, about relationships, about love also. In fact, there are people, and most of the people feel that even love is a possession. Now, people will have possessions with them. So, and they will be lost. That is the nature. That's how nature has created life around us. So I told you, if you're a little sensitive towards the life around you, towards people around you, you will find this poem extremely interesting. And it's telling you a very, very important, rule of life and nature. I can take, use the word rule over here, because nature has created things around us in such a way that today, if I have anything, tomorrow, it will be lost from me. So be it your youth, your beauty, your age, your experience, your intelligence, everything is temporary. Everything is temporary. So tomorrow you're going to lose it, even if they are the most loving relationships. So the most loving relationship in the whole world is the bond that a parent shares with his or her child. That is the most, according to me, the most beautiful relationship. Now even that is also going to get lost. Nothing is permanent in this world. And he says that people will take balls, people will have relationships, people will have possessions, people will, own up things, but then those will be lost. And this is the rule of the nature. This is how nature has created all of us. So all, everything that you have, how much ever sensitive and loving those things, how much ever sensitive you are towards those loving things, these things will be lost one day. Like that child has, lost his ball while playing. Money is external. Before that, there is one line. And no one buys a ball back. No one buys a ball back. There is this word buy, B-U-Y, buy. But why do you think the word buy is used? I feel buying is that you get it in exchange of something, and that exchange, in exchange of something, is really money. Now once again, money is also a kind of possession. You have worked somewhere, you got money. You are in a business, you get money, whatever. There are various ways of earning money. But against money, you will get a replacement, as I told you, of the thing, but you are never going to get that original things again. Right, so he says that people will buy things, people will they will have things, but they are never going to buy, no one buys a ball back, so nobody is going to have that possession back. Why? Because a replacement is possible, its replication is possible, that the same thing is not possible even with exchange of money. And then the next he says, a very small sentence, but a very suggestive one. He says, money is external. Now, it's a very small sentence, just three words over here, but he's actually conveying a very complex idea to you. He's saying money is external, something which is outside of you. But the memory and the love of that possession is something that lies within you. Now, even if you spend money, can you get those memories and that person, relationship, whatever it was, back? So the boy, the happiness that he had, after playing with that particular ball, now he has created a bond with the ball. You would have often, noticed little kids sleeping with their toys, actually just carrying those toys like babies wherever they go. So it could be a soft toy. You would find little children sleeping with them, tightly hugging them. I mean, they have formed a bond, an emotional bond with that thing. So similarly, the boy had also formed the emotional bond with the ball. Not that the ball is lost. If he buy a better ball from what he had, is he going to share, or is he going to get the same emotional bond, the same emotional bond which he shared with that particular ball? Probably not. He's never going to get that kind of happiness again. Now, it will be a different kind of a bond with that different ball, but not the same one. Original is never going to get back to him, right? So he says that money is external. It will not buy you inner peace. It will not buy you inner happiness. It will not buy you inner satisfaction and love and memories that you have actually received after creating a bond that particular thing. The last four lines I'm reading now from the book, he's learning. well behind his desperate eyes, the epistemology of loss, how to stand up, knowing what everyone, every man must know, one day know that most know, many days how to stand up. Right, so he's saying that, you know, he's learning now. So as I told you, it is a journey of life that each one of us is set out to, like this little child, and he's also learning. So even in loss, there is a teaching, there is a learning. And nature, this is the nature's way of teaching us. This is the nature's way of making us more intelligent, and it teaches you. It keeps on teaching you until you learn your lesson. And he says that the boy is also learning, and he's learning what all the men after a certain period of time learn, that things will be lost. So he's learning well behind his desperate eyes. Desperate eyes means that behind his eyes, which are now loveless, which are now crying eyes. So behind those crying eyes, he is now learning the epistemology of loss, the understanding of loss. It's like he's trying to understand the nature of loss now, right? How to stand up, knowing what every man must know, one day know. Knowing what every man must one day know, and most know many days, right? So he says that he's also now going to grow up. So growing up is not just growing old in age, but growing up is growing in mind and growing with knowledge. And what is that growth? That growth is about learning the epistemology of laws, or understanding the nature of laws that almost everyone has learned, and they had learned, you know, on a particular day or one day, all of them one day learn, and they know that how to stand up against this loss. So one has to build up courage, one needs to build up that strength within, which is within again. It's not like money, which is outside, but it is like strength, courage, hope, love, and understanding, which gets within you. And this is these within knowledge, you know, that is something that makes you growing up, that results into the evolution of a human being into a more better human being. So the poem is then about life. The poem is about understanding how to grow and overgrow the loss that has happened to you. The poem is about understanding that, is there any point in suffering over the loss, because loss will anyway happen. The poem is about trying to realize your true potential, which lies within the layer of sufferings actually. So you need not actually suffer. The day you start pulling up all these, you know, layers of suffering, you start discovering your true self. And there is this innate desire within human being. You know, that is something that makes us different from other living species on this planet, is something, you know, that we don't just exist to eat and sleep and to reproduce, but there is an innate desire within us to achieve something which is much more than what we are right now. The desire is to become greater in character and to understand the inner potential. So there is a potential within all of us, but you need to discover it. And how do you discover it? By understanding life, by understanding loss, by understanding suffering and pain. All these things you must understand, that you live in a world where there are possessions. You cannot escape that. How much ever basic life you are living, there would be some or other kind of possessions that you have. And these possessions might not always be in the form of luxuries, but they might be in the form of your relationships. And you need to understand that even these loving relationships, the most cherished one, no, that all of us have, they are temporary. Now this is a difficult understanding, but a very useful one. It is very useful because you need to realize that everything around you is just temporary. So we need to get over it, and we need to understand that till then it is there with me. I need to enjoy each and every moment with my loved one, with my relationships, with the people around me. But the day it is going to go away from me, on that day, I'm not going to suffer. I'm just going to let go of it, because that is how it will happen. right? So this is how the poem is about. Go through it and try to come up with your own understanding, and if possible, put your thoughts into writing. That is important. Why? From examination point of view, that is one thing. Secondly, it help you to, you know, improve your writing skills. Thirdly, sometimes there is this gap between you feel you have understood something, but when it comes to expression, there would be certain gaps and there would be certain obstacles. So just put them in writing also. In a rough notebook, just write down about whatever you want to write. And if you are able to write for a considerable period of time, then you have understood it. But if you are feeling a loss of words, if you're thinking that you're not getting enough ideas, then probably you might just need to go back to the poem again. So with this, I'll just end this video. Thank you so much for being with me throughout this video, and I hope it is going to be helpful to you. Thank you so much.